Okay, thank you. So good morning, everyone. Thanks to the organizer to give me the opportunity to have a stay here. And I'm happy to present to you some results that we obtained with Sara Del Cengio, who is doing a postdoc in LIFI in Grenoble, and Matteo Politini, who works in Luxembourg. And the talk is a bit with a half foot in the topics of this workshop. I would like to describe to you some tools that we have designed in order to depict how non-equilibrium arises in a chemical reaction network or in reaction network in general. So. The main question is how do systems dissipate energy and how we can characterize the drive in a geometrical manner. So I will start by motivating this by telling that there are reaction networks that are important in living matter, and if you want to depict them, you have to use hypergraphs where here. Every node, every circle is a species, and every square is a reaction. And it's difficult to know where the drive comes from in these settings. So let's start by the simplest system that one can depict, just to see which intuition we can obtain. So consider a simple particle on a ring of position x, force F, and noise eta. So we know that if we decompose the force as minus the derivative of a periodic function plus a constant, a scalar f defined here, the potential V of x describes the conservative motion, and the scalar function f describes the drive, in the sense that one is at equilibrium if this drive is equal to zero, and this is if and only if the dynamics is reversible with respect to the Boltzmann weight here with the potential V, and this tells that the current is zero. So we all know that very well, but this system is somehow a bit irrealistic, so that's our motivation to go to more complex system. So already how things go in a higher dimension, so let's say we take a particle in R2 and R3, again subjected to Langevin dynamics, and we know that if we use the Helmholtz-Holtz decomposition, to write the force as, which is vectorial now, as minus the gradient of a scalar plus a force, a solenoid force, this vocabulary comes from electromagnetism, with a zero divergence. This gives a unique decomposition in R2 or R3 with a conservative and driving contribution. And again, one has equilibrium if and only if that solenoid part is zero. And there is reversibility at the stochastic level if one has a Langevin equation with respect to the Boltzmann weight. So what's helpful in this decomposition? What is helpful is that one can describe how the dynamics occurs. And the conservative part derives from a potential, and I have depicted one here, which is confining, and the gradient force follow this shape. So in electromagnetism, there would be sources located there. And for this sort of conservative field, one has the divergence theorem, so the surface integral reduces to a line integral in R2, or the volume integral reduces to a surface integral in R3. And more importantly, there is, thanks to Stokes' theorem, the loop integral of that force is equal to zero on a loop. So it means that if you want to reconstitute the potential from the force, you can integrate from an origin fixed arbitrarily and obtain the force by integrating, obtain the potential, sorry, by integrating the force. And for the solenoid part, so the part that drives the system, here is an example. It has a zero divergence, so it means that it's constituted of current, and this effect is really to make particle turn, if you like, in R2 or R3. So now, how can we build the same for systems that are not in a continuous space R2 or R3, but that are complex reaction networks? I have given you here a more specific example than the previous time. is the reaction network that describes how prebiotic chemicals can lead to self-assembly in a chemical sense. And this system is involving a lot of reactions that are themselves in contact with reservoirs, so which act as a source of irreversibility in this problem. And when we like to see how the previous geometrical intuition can be transported to this case. So let me be a bit more specific. So I will consider here systems that are described as chemical species here. So at the molecular level, you have different compounds, and they are in contact with different baths here. And each of them can withstand individual reactions. So here, the species are governed or denoted X1 to X5. And you can have the 2X1 go into X3 with some rates. And you can have interacting reactions like this one. So how do we depict this? It's a discrete problem. And the way to write this is to use what people call a hypergraph. So you have a node for every species here, 1 to 5. And for the 4 reactions, you draw how the interaction goes. So for instance, for reaction 4, here you have X5 that can be transformed, or X1 plus X4, so it can be transformed in X5 and vice versa. So this sort of object is not that easy to manipulate at first. So I will focus first on the case of non-interacting systems. So in these settings, Hill and Schnackenberg in the 60s and 70s, they have built tools that allow one to understand how the stationary non-equilibrium arises in this system. And this is thanks to the identification of the role of chemical cycles. So they will play the same role as the periodic nature of the ring on the very first example that I presented to you. And this followed the work done of Kirchhoff on electrical circuit and Markov for stochastic models. So this works so either for non-interacting chemical reaction or at a microscopic level of description, so really at the level of population level, where you can have a graph, because this approach is based on graph theory, where cycles are important. So this is quite helpful, but if you want to put it in practice for a large system, this is in fact impractical, because you have to write the network at the population's level, so identify from which population of every species you go from and to at for every reaction. So it's difficult to have really a macroscopic description of the system. And also, this approach is mainly useful to identify the steady state source of non-equilibrium. So understanding how the finite time dynamics takes place is more complex. So we wonder how one can describe the transient even in a non-linear manner or in a non-perturbative manner compared to equilibrium steady state. So I will present you first the case of non-interacting network and graph, so part of their work and some extension, because it's helpful to build an intuition and to build the geometrical tools. And there will be a back and forth mechanism between the algebraic description and the graph theoretical description. And I will start by geometry, arrive to algebra. And then I will switch to interacting networks, where we have identified a common structure that will help to build geometrical tools. And in the end, I will describe you some application of these methodologies. So how does it work? We consider a set of n reactions and n species and O reactions. So to every species, you associate a node, and to every reaction, you associate an edge. So let me take a reaction between, for instance, 3 and 4. Species 3 and 4 can transform into one another with these weights. And to every of these unimolecular reactions, we associate an edge with an orientation that is arbitrary. And you see here the set of reactions presents no interaction in the sense that you don't have two species or a duplication of a given species that transform into one or more species. So this is why this is called non-interacting or unimolecular. Yes, so I will only consider reactions that indeed can go in one and the other direction, but indeed, one possibility is to put an arrow without, to put an edge without any orientation, but the arrow with two orientations, so you don't distinguish somehow between these two nodes, but it will be helpful to consider an arbitrary orientation. Keep this in mind. You can, at the moment, ignore completely the orientation if you like. It's just a convention. You see, this reaction, I wrote it with x3 on the left, x4 on the right. But I could have written it in the other direction. So when I write the reaction, I break the symmetry between the two species. And this is what I do here by picking one orientation. So the rate, for instance, if you consider chemical reaction network, these rates, they will describe you really the
in the network.
They are just constants at the moment. Like this will tell the probability per unit time that you transform. Okay, they are not written. So you have to. Exactly. So if you want me to be a bit specific, so to every reaction row that is an edge here, you will also have a table of the rates k plus rho, k minus rho, and they are not written here. They are just really describing the dynamics, while this object only describes the network of interactions that exist there. Yeah, exactly. You have to pick one of the two. It will be when I will express here the currents, it will be a bit clearer why there is this arbitrariness. At the moment, take every edge just as arbitrarily oriented from one to the other. Have I convinced you, or not yet? That. Okay, so bear with me for now. So this is the oriented graph. We consider connected graph without loss of generality. Again, n nodes or edges. And the first concept I would like to introduce you is the concept of spanning tree. It's a subset of the reaction that has no loop and that still cover every node. So here, you had to remove this reaction and that reaction and this one here. The spanning tree is not unique. It's just a set of reactions. And these reactions, you see, they are independent, one from each other. In that circle here, in that loop, if I apply this reaction in that direction or these two reactions in these two directions, so this and that, I will obtain the same result. So these three reactions are not independent, and the spanning tree is a maximal set of independent reactions. It's not unique, but it will always contain the same number of edges. So now that I fix one of the spanning tree, I will distinguish two sorts of reactions or two sorts of edges. The blue one here, which are independent, I will call them co-chord, sorry for the typo here. They will be indexed by gamma, so they will be in blue in what follows. And the chords are in red. I will index them by alpha. And any time we add a chord here in red, we restore one of the cycles. Here there were three independent cycles, so there are three chords in red here. Yes. So here, yeah, I really take a connected graph to start with. If I don't have a connected graph, I will study every connected component independently, one from the other. But then indeed, about breaking, you also notice that whenever you remove one of the cochord in blue, you will break the head, the nodes, the species into two subgroups. So this is a concept that we can build for graph, and that will be useful in the following. Just to give you a taste of what will happen, you see that here the cochords, they will govern, or they will allow one to describe cycles, so they will be associated to non-equilibrium drive, while the cords here in blue are associated to potential forces. You see that if you fix one of the nodes here, you can always have a unique path connecting any other node to this one. So you will be able to define an integration similar to what you want to do when you integrate the potential force and want to reconstitute the potential. So let me now introduce the two core concepts that I will try to explain to you in the non-interacting and in the interacting case later, which are the cycle and co-cycle. So let me start by the cycle. Here, graphically, a cycle is a loop. And chemically, a cycle is a set of reactions that, when applied in a given order, will leave the system invariant. So here, let's say I will transform species X3 into X4, X4 into X5, and X5 into X3. So if I apply this series of reactions, I will leave the system unchanged at the microscopic level and at the population level too. Now, there is a dual concept, which is the one of co-cycle. So remember, previously I had picked a spanning tree in blue, and I told you that whenever I remove one of the cochord indexed by gamma, I break the system into two parts. So let me focus on that cochord gamma here in blue. It has an orientation, so I will define a source component and a target component. I will call this a source island and a target island. So since removing a cochord, one split the tree or the species into two islands, one wonder how these two islands are connected in the original graph. And this is what a co-cycle tells. The co-cycle is the set of edges here that connect the two islands. It's not only the cochord I have removed, but it's also the other graphs, the other edges that were present in the original graph that connect the two islands. So you see, you can associate to every island a boundary, and this boundary is what connects this island to the rest of the species, and that boundary is a co-cycle. And conversely, whenever you have a co-cycle, you can associate a source target, a source island, and a targeted island. Yes? Yes. Exactly. And there are as many cochords as co-cycle, so I index also them by gamma. And this number of cochords or co-cycle, it's a number that describes how many independent reactions there are and how many independent species there are. It's the same number. You will see soon why. Yes? They are dual to cycle. You see, if you have a planar graph, you can always construct a dual graph where edges are replaced by species and vice versa, and then co-cycle transform into cycle. That's the origin of the name. Duality could be helpful, but we didn't find a usefulness for now. Yes? So the co-cycle is really, indeed, is unique to every cochord, to every independent reaction that I picked in the spanning tree. I have a unique co-cycle, and indeed, I didn't give detail about the orientation. So if I come back, so remember here, sorry, the orientation of the co-cycle is that they will point from the source island to the target island. So this is this set of orientation. If I now come back to the original graph, that is this one, the orientation, sorry, maybe it's not this one. So let me, it is this one. So the three components that belong to the co-cycle are these three ones, and the orientation here is not necessarily the same as the one of the co-cycle. So do you see, this is why I need to originally fix a given orientation. This will fix me the race, this will fix me the force, in fact, that acts, the expression of the force that acts between these two species. And then relative to this orientation, I will define a co-cycle. And the co-cycle, in a sense, is not only given by the set of these three edges, it's also given by their orientation relative to the original orientation of the graph. So here, for instance, I would have, let's say, a plus one because it's oriented in the same direction as the original graph. Here a plus one and here a minus one because it's not oriented in the same way as in the original graph. So this is, and I will come back to this later, how we will represent algebraically this, these co-cycles later. And regarding the unicity, it's unique once you fix the spanning tree, but the spanning tree is not unique. So everything that I will say, in a sense, will depend on the choice of spanning tree, but that many quantities won't depend of this arbitrary orientation, of this arbitrary choice. It's a bit like if you want to reconstruct a potential in R2 or in R3 from a conservative field, you fix an origin and you integrate from it. This choice of origin is really like the choice of a spanning tree and a specific node in it. So do you have more questions? So let me now express why this is useful and how this can be interesting to describe the dynamics of chemical reaction networks. So let me consider the average behavior of the concentration, which is the number of species per volume in the large volume limit. So I collect this into a vector of n components, n concentrations. Its time evolution is given by a conservation equation with a matrix S, the stoichiometric matrix, and a current J. So I have written it on the blackboard. The stoichiometric matrix is a matrix of R columns and N lines, R being the number of fractions and N the number of species. And to every species, the on the line, you have how it is involved in the reaction, and in the same way, into every reaction row, to every column row, you have how the species is involved in the reaction. So I've given you an example for this set of reactions, so oriented in that way. So for the first reaction here, by convention, you write plus one if the reaction creates a particle and minus one if it destroys one particle. So the reaction here, one, is encoded in that column and the same there. So for non-interacting networks, you only have plus one and minus one, and this matrix is an incidence matrix of the graph. So you have a minus for this reaction here. It will be written as x2 goes into x1, and I have a minus one there for species two, because maybe I can write it in the way I decide to write the reaction. It's x2, x1, I destroy x1 and I create, I destroy x2 and I create x1. So you see, Martin, this is why I need to break the degeneracy here. The reaction is reversible, it can happen in two ways, but I have to encode the writing that I decide to pick up. Another way, and some people do it, is to write an extended stoichiometric matrix where there would be a column per reaction. So x1 goes to x2 and x2 goes to x1, but I won't choose this viewpoint there. So J, here, yeah, the current, I will go to it. So you see, this tells how the concentration evolves in time. So the matrix S tell for each species how the reaction are involved. And the expression of J is that there is one J per reaction row, and now the rate come into play. It tells how much the plus part of the reaction contributes to the increase of the concentration X, and how much here it contributes to decreasing. So if I take a unimolecular reaction, rho, I have a source species, a target species. This is the reaction there. The rates here, the rho indices are missing. The rate is given by this. So that equation for the non-interacting case is really a linear equation in X. If now I would have interacting chemical reaction, it would be non-linear in the concentrations. So, yes. Yes, this one. So this is reaction 4 and species 4. So reaction 4, I have not numbered the reaction there. So I guess this is this reaction. You see species 3 and 5 are involved. So this species, 2 and 5 are involved. So sorry. The fourth reaction is that one. It's involving species 2, species 5. Species 5 destroyed, that's why there is a minus 1. Species 2 is created, that's why there is a plus 1. So although this equation is linear in X, it will be helpful to introduce the force, and this is done in a nonlinear way. So let me factor that equation by the first term here and write it in that form. So this is k plus rho x times 1 minus the affinity of reaction rho, where the affinity of reaction rho is, here you can reconstitute it, the log of the ratio of the rates times the ratio of these two concentration ponderated, these two concentrations. So when you make this ratio of concentration, in fact, you obtain the entry rho of the stoichiometric matrix. Here, this is a vector writing. So this is the product of the xi minus s I rho. So when A is equal to 0, you have no current. So this is why this quantity defined by chemists as the affinity of reaction rho really plays the role of a force. And I will explain to you how this analogy can be pushed really quite far. So to summarize, I have a graph reaction of this form for every edge between two species. And to every edge, the nodes which are species, one can associate to them concentration. And to every edge, there is also a force, the affinity here, that tells how the current that goes between these two species is far away from zero. So these definitions, I wrote them for non-interacting reactions, but they can be easily generalized for the interacting case. So now let's come back to the graph and see how the algebraic representation of cycle and co-cycle is helpful to understand the dynamics. So to every cycle in green here, I define a column vector, C alpha, and its entries are given by how each reaction is involved. So to every cocord, there will be a 1, and then there is the composition of the cycle. So I can fill the column with the column of these entries, a matrix that takes this form. So it's up to a relabeling of the species, but to every cocord, there will be one for the cocord associated to a cycle, and then the composition of the cycle is described by a matrix T. I can do the same here. To every co-cycle, I have a cocord, this was this one, and I fill a vector with the entries of this vector telling how much the reaction are involved. So there is again a part of this matrix here of all the co-cycles that is the identity, because to every co-chord isolated co-cycle. And this other part of that matrix here is, again, a matrix that tells the composition here. So to this co-chord, for instance, I have a one in one of the entries of this identity matrix. And then this matrix T transpose tells how the other edges are involved in the co-cycle. So with a plus one or minus one, depending on whether these edges here in the co-cycle are oriented parallel or anti-parallel to the original orientation of the graph. So don't really try to follow every sign here. Just bear in mind that it's a matrix T that tells the composition of every co-cycle and the composition of every cycle. And it's not a mistake that I use the same letter here. I have a matrix minus T and a matrix T transpose. And that's really a non-trivial duality between cycle and co-cycle. That is the very same matrix up to a sign and the transpose that tells the composition of the cycles and the co-cycles. And it's not easy to prove graphically. You can also prove it algebraically. And it's not a two-line proof. But that's the interest of graph theory here is that you have objects that you can use. And what is the quantity M here? So there is a typo. M is the rank of S. So this is what I've written in yellow on the blackboard. M tells the number of co-cycles, and it also is related to the number of cycles. If you have M co-cycles, so M independent reactions, you have or minus M cycles. So this comes from algebra. Now, what can we do algebraically with this now vectors of cycles and co-cycles? You notice here that defined in this way, the cycles and co-cycles are orthogonal. You take a vector here, a column of this matrix, another column of that matrix, and because of this sign and this transpose, each of them will be orthogonal. And you can show that the space spanned by the cycle is the kernel of the socketing matrix, and the space spanned by these co-cycles is the image of the transpose of S. And the rank nullity theorem tells that these two spaces are indeed in orthogonal and complementary, and they give or to the or here or the real numbers and or the number of reactions. So from an algebraic viewpoint, the cycles and the co-cycles, they are bases, well-chosen bases of the kernel and the image of S transpose. Yes? To a species and vice versa. I would have to take a few minutes to explain to you, but it's not an easy mapping. I mean, you would have to allow for reactions that that are single loops from a species to another. No, I think it's reversible. Yeah. So to summarize, we have structure in this set of reactions, the cycles associated to non-equilibrium, and the co-cycles that will be associated to potential. And from an algebraic viewpoint, the cycles are a base of the kernel, and the co-cycles a base of the image of S transpose. So now, let's see how this is helpful for dynamics. I remember here the dynamics of the concentration. It's Sj with j obtained from the expressed as a function of concentration of the and the affinities in that way. So let's now consider the force as a vector. And because I have a base given by the co-cycles here and the chords there, so it's the base is not the co-cycle and the cycle. Here, it's the co-cycles and the edges that were used to define the chord. So this is in green here, I will define them as a cycle affinity. So you can show also that it's equal to the scalar product between the affinity and the cycle vector. So it's the sum of the affinity along a cycle. Remember, affinity is a force to every edge you can associate one. And this tells, this gives the sum of all the affinities along a cycle, and this gives that component. And the condition for the affinity to be conservative is that every cycle affinity is zero. So you have no force on cycles. And this is equivalent here. If this is zero, you have that affinity. The affinity is a sum over the co-cycle. So the co-cycle that spans the image of S transpose. So this is equivalent to the affinity being in the image of S transpose, or to the existence of potential V such that A is minus the gradient of V. I represent the transpose of the stoichiometric matrix as a gradient because it transforms a scalar, that is to say, values given on every species into a vector, which are the forces between every species on the graph. So at this level, it's an analogy where S is read either as here a divergence or a gradient, but it's more than that, in the sense that you can show that in the same way as for stochastic dynamics, being a gradient for a force is, tells that the dynamics is reversible. Here, if every cycle affinity is zero, it's equivalent to have that for every cycle, the product of the forward race and the backward race, so the k-rows, is equal to one. This is easy to show. And you recognize here the Kolmogorov criterion for reversibility. So this is equivalent to having that the dynamics of the particles is reversible. So that's an interesting feature of this construction, and this was already put forward by Schnackenberg. This cycle affinity, in fact, they don't depend on the concentrations, and they are a finite number of real numbers, so of scalars that tell how much the system is driven out of equilibrium. And again, here what is interesting is that this reversibility is really equivalent to having that the force is minus the gradient of a potential. So this is the interest of the cocycle. The cocycle, they tell how the potential forces are organized between between islands, and they serve as a basis for the potential forces. Another aspect is that somehow this decomposition is really like the Helmholtz decomposition that I presented to you before in R2 or R3 for a field. It's decomposing the vector here of forces into a potential and a driving force. And you can show here that you have, I don't show it, but you have also the equivalent of Stokes theorem for this contribution. You can integrate it on a loop and you will obtain zero. Yes? So they are the electric fields, but the one deriving from charges that are placed on the nodes. You can really push this in the sense you can have an electrostatics on the graph, and if you come back to Kirchhoff's description of electric circuit, this is really that you can depict this V as the potential, and the affinity is in a linear regime would be the voltage different between different different nodes. Yeah. And so what are my electric field? What are the solenoid part? This is this part. You see, if I go to a graph and I depict this now as an electric circuit. So if I have no source of field, I will never have a current on the loop. And so you need something else. And indeed, you need either a magnetic field or you can have a source of current there. So how to associate a geometry now? You remember that to this Helmholtz decomposition, I have told you how one can depict them in a geometrical manner. So the case of cycles is simple. Your cycle is really a cyclic loop on the graph. So let's go to the co-cycle. So I remember you, to every co-chord, I associate a target and a source, which are the two components of the graph. and the co-cycle is what connects one and the other. So this C gamma, the entry, its entries can be seen as a gradient of potential between source and target island. So what is the potential from which this co-cycle derives? One can show that it's a simple potential, it's a characteristic potential. So let me put a potential one on every node of the source island and zero on the other side. And if you do so, and you apply the gradient operator to that characteristic potential, you do obtain the co-cycle. So the co-cycle is really the field generated by a very simple landscape of potential, one on the source island and zero elsewhere. So in that sense, the basis for conservative forces or conservative affinities is given by this very simple set of landscape of potentials where you have flat islands characteristic of every source island of every target. So now, because I told you that this potential forces, so if they live on the co-cycles, they are the gradient of potential, how can one identify the potential? So we can use the island I described to you, but there is a nicer way. So for this, let me define a matrix G transpose, where for every column, I fill these entries by the characteristic potentials, the V gamma I told you before. So for instance, for this column, I have a one associated to species 3 and 4, and zero elsewhere. So, and on top of that, I fill a one full of one, and this line here in red. So interestingly, you can read this matrix not by column, but by lines. And to every line now is filled as follow. You fix a root in the system. So let's say here the root is this node one. And to every node, there is a unique path that connects this node to the root. And you fill one on every reaction that you meet. So for instance, you could take a node here four and connect it to the root. And you have that reaction four is not involved, but reaction three to one are involved. So this gives the zero and one, one, one. And you can organize them upon an arbitrary orientation of the edges here in such a way that this matrix GT is triangular. So what you can show now is that the potential is given by GT applied to these affinities here. And from the triangular structure, you see that it's a sum of the affinities along the path that connect the root and the node. So to summarize this algebraic derivation, to obtain the potential of a node, you take the unique path that connect it to a given to a fixed root, and you sum the affinities that you meet along this this route. So it's really an integration on the spanning tree. And you can show that the result does not depend on the choice of route and on the choice of spanning tree up to a global constant. So this is really the equivalent of integrating in R2 along a path. So this is how also you can continue this analogy between potential and forces to depict the affinities really as deriving from a potential that can be integrated along this this spanning tree. And you also notice, and this will be an interesting point for later, that GT plays the role of a sort of inverse of green function for S. Because look at this equation, R is equal to S transpose V, and this is V is equal to G transpose applied to A. And if you translate this relation in a matrix manner, you obtain that, so up to signs here, minus S transpose times G transpose is equal to identity, and then again this matrix T. So it means that you have inverted the part of the stoichiometric matrix that could be inverted. So this is just an algebraic remark now, but later it will be useful to go to the interacting case. let me switch, let me skip the decomposition of the current, but you can also play with the geometry by picking another base for the current and depict stationary and non-stationary current, non-stationary current being associated to co-cycles. So let me now go to the case of interacting systems. So there, I have picked a set of reactions here. Now they are interacting because species can group to transform into other. And this is depicted by a hypergraph. So here to each reaction in a given color, I associated a hyper edge here in a given color. So hyper edge is just reaction node here, or reaction square, and the different arrows tell how the reaction is involved. So the issue here is that you cannot use graph theory. There is no notion of spanning tree, no notion of co-cycle. So one can wonder how to proceed, and the route that we'll just sketch you is a mirror to the previous route. I will start from algebra and arrive at geometry. So let's start with cycles. So the change compared to the non-interacting case is that now cycles will be a weighted set of reactions leaving the system unchanged. So I have taken here this set of reactions. The stoichiometric matrix is given there. The graph is here. And you notice that if you apply reaction one, let's say one time, reaction two one time, reaction three zero, and reaction four twice, this leaves the system invariant. And this vector here, in fact, is a member, or is a vector that belongs to the kernel of S. And the cycles will be a well-chosen base for the kernel of S. And the difference now is that they are a weighted set of fractions. They can be positive, negative entries. And you can show that you can always take fractional entries or integer entries, even if you like. And the cycle here, this green vector, is now involving this set of reactions here with some weights. So it's not easy to have a graphical representation, but you have an algebraic representation of that cycle there. So this is the easy part. Let's now go to the co-cycles, and this is what we want to bring forward. So let's start from algebra. You can use a method that is called row reduction in echelon form of a matrix. So you take a matrix S, its rank is M, and you can show that if you reorder reaction and species so that the first M reaction are independent and the last M species are independent, you can find an invertible matrix G such that G times S takes this structure. So G is, for instance, can be obtained by Gauss-Jordan elimination when you want to solve a linear problem, but you can also find explicit expressions for G. So this is really the same relation as before up to a transpose. So this is really the key equation to build generalized co-cycles and a good choice for the base of the kernel, so for the cycles. So the difference is now that the entries of T are fractional. It says of the plus one, minus one that we're telling the relative orientation of cycles and co-cycles with respect to the original choice of orientation. And the same for G. Now, G is not necessarily triangular. Nevertheless, from this matrix T here, you can again define a set of cycle and co-cycle vectors, which are the columns of these two matrices. They are exactly written the same way. Again, the difference is that this T matrix T is not built graphically, but it's built algebraically. And they still span two orthogonal spaces, the kernel and the S of S and the image of S transpose. So much of what I've told you from an algebraic viewpoint really holds because the algebraic structure is exactly the same as before, except that now the rank can take any value. Before, the rank was a fixed function of the number of species. So you can again decompose the force into conservative and driving contribution. You can decompose current into tidal and stationary contribution, which I did not describe you. And having conservative affinity is again equivalent to having reversible population dynamics, as you can show. So what about the geometry that is related to this objects. So the result I give it to you is given by the structure of G transpose. Now, instead of the column of one, and the full of one, and the line of zero, I have other contributions here that I will ignore. And there is a subpart, sub M by M matrix, which are what I will call escape routes. So the line entries, which were the integration paths, will now be again integration paths, but with weights. So let me come back to the graph. I here come back to the structure of GT. The columns, you remember, they were the islands. And now the lines are the integration paths to a route. So if I take now, let's say, the last line here, the red part involves species 5 and species, reaction 5 and reaction 2. So these are these two reactions, and they are zeros elsewhere. So just a reminder that for graph, the line entries of this red subpart of GT describe which path you have to follow to integrate on the spanning tree. So now if you go to the hypergraph, there is still this core here, this red core of GT. And let me depict to you how it works. So now instead of having one extra column here, I have two columns. So it means that I have not one route, but two routes on the hypergraph. So here is the hypergraph corresponding to this matrix G transpose. These two nodes here are the routes, so they are in red here and there. And these three hypergraphs here are a representation of the three routes that are now not simple paths that you follow on a tree, but they are a combination of reactions with given weights. So the first line here corresponds to the single reaction that is involved. This second line here is the more complex because it involves three reactions with given weights, remember there. And the last line involves these two reactions. So if you want to integrate the affinity in order to get the potential, in fact, the chemical potential, you can do it by integrating along this escape route here. Yes? Yes. So it's again defined in the same way. You write the current as a difference between two polynomials in the concentration, and you factorize it. And the affinity is now a ratio of rates of reactions times concentration. So they are really functions of the affinities. So what is interesting is that even if the dynamics is really nonlinear in the concentration and in the affinity, this algebraically derived construction really, really, really holds. And you can also depict now, you can go to the columns, and now the columns, you see they are not only one and zeros, they are entries with signs and fractional entries, and they correspond to island with a non-flat geography. And the co-cycles are the boundary in the sense that they are the gradient of this island. So I can make an analogy here. This is the map of climbing routes on El Capitan. So now instead of having a flat island, you have an island with a geography. And the path of integration, they are not simple routes. Now they have intersection here, depending on which way you take. So how to apply this? So one interesting feature is that you can describe part of the nonlinear dynamics of this problem. So the island population, which is just the entries of the concentration weighted by the altitude or the geography of the island, so it's a linear combination of the concentration, they constitute independent degrees of freedom, while the xi's are interdependent. And somehow the co-cycles are boundaries. So imagine that you have a set of reactions, and that one of the reactions is very slow, and that you can tune its rate. So if you apply this procedure to every reaction, in general, nothing will happen. While if you apply it to a boundary of an island, so to a set of reactions which is a co-cycle, you will isolate an island, and this is what happens. So I go fast here, but these are the populations of the different ions, so they are the modes of the system. And if you suppress reaction gradually, that is not a co-cycle, you have a small differences before and after the suppression here on the dynamics, the nonlinear dynamics of the ions. While if you suppress the reaction that is associated or that is a co-cycle, then a new time scale appears, and this corresponds to the fact that there is a new conservation law emerging in the system. And this you can apply for one cycle, but you can apply it also for several co-cycles, sorry. So you can really design evolution where you have a series of relaxation that occur in a nonlinear manner in this way. Very fastly, the potential I told you about is in fact the chemical potential of chemistry. You can read the details in our preprint. And another aspect is about what happens in the linear response. So remember, the same matrix T describes cycles and co-cycles. And there is an interesting consequence that lies in the linear response. Linear response, you can either consider the transient response to a small time perturbation in equilibrium, so in reversible dynamics, or a steady state response due to a small field. So you obtain two matrices. They don't have the same dimensions, but the fact that you have the very same matrix T, so these two matrices are copied here, allows one to show that these two response matrices, so they are two Onsager matrices, if you like, they have the same spectra up to the multiplicities of zeros and one, which are not important. So to summarize, I've told you how to build a geography of chemical reaction, and we can wonder how to use that to express the steady state. So on graph, there is a Kirchhoff formula that is a sum over the spanning tree. So we can wonder here if we can sum over escape routes, if we can obtain the same description. And there we can also, and this is also detailed in our preprint, use the methodology to design a scheme for metabolic reconstruction. So imagine in chemistry you have a set of reactions. You know what species are involved, but you don't know what are the rates, or and you can only measure currents. And from the currents, you have to reconstitute the rates. And our methodology in the linear regime, closed equilibrium, can give an answer. And maybe from a larger perspective, the species I've told about, they were chemical, but you can imagine evolution process with mutation and selection, and the species now become biological, or they become alleles. So you can wonder how the tools we put forward can be helpful. And with this, I thank you for your attention.